prayer service is printed in your worship folder this morning, Divine Service Setting 4. Please rise for confession and absolution. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. If you, O Lord, have a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
With you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, call upon him in prayer and praise, and receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God and Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ, and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his only Son to die for you, and for his sake he forgives you all of your sin. As a called and ordained servant of the Word, I announce to you the grace of God, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sin in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Is now and will be forever. Amen.
God, so rule and govern our hearts and minds by your Holy Spirit, that ever mindful of your final judgment, we may be stirred up to holiness of living here and dwell with you in perfect joy hereafter. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
The Old Testament reading for the seventh Sunday after Pentecost is from Isaiah chapter 44. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last. Besides me there is no good God. Who is like me? Let him proclaim it. Let him declare and set it before me, since I appointed an ancient people. Let them declare what is to come and what will happen. Fear not, nor be afraid. Have I not told you from of old and declared it? And you are my witnesses. Is there a God besides me? There is no rock. I know not any. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom and knowledge of God. How unsearchable are his judgments. How inscrutable his ways. For from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen.
The epistle is from Romans chapter 8, verses 18 through 27. For I consider that sufferings of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed to us. For the creation waits with eager longing for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself will be set free from its bondage to decay and obtain the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation has been growing together in the pains of childbirth until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope, we are saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. And he who searches hearts knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
One who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The
field is the world, and the good seed is the children of his kingdom. The weeds are the sons of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the close of the age, and the reapers are the angels. Just as the weeds are gathered and burned with fire, so it will be at the close of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will gather out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all lawbreakers, and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. He who has ears, let him hear. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We confess our faith together in the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
They're just a group of regular guys, those first disciples of Jesus. None of them were rote scholars, so I don't expect amazing prose to roll off their tongues every time they speak. I don't expect profound and deep thoughts to be uttered, but good heavens, sometimes it just seemed like they were so dense. I mean, by the time Matthew 13 comes along in our gospel for today, they've been with Jesus for a couple of years, so one would think that they had mastered the basics by now. The kingdom of heaven is like a field planted with good seed, and an enemy comes in and oversows it with weeds. God made the world holy and perfect, and Satan introduced sin and brokenness. Duh. Why do the disciples need this parable to be explained? It reminds me of something Danya says to me occasionally when I'm talking about something at church that seems obvious to me but does not seem obvious to her. And she'll say to me, "Okay, but remember now, you're the only one that lives there." It's easy for pastors to sometimes assume that everyone has right at the tip of their brains all of the important teachings of Christianity. But when we do that, we risk the truth being overlooked. It's easy for pastors to forget that not everybody in the flock is so immersed in God's word the way he is. And Jesus, being the perfect pastor, the perfect shepherd, does not make that mistake. And so you see, Jesus explained the parable. In fact, Jesus explains the same message again and again and again throughout the Gospels. God created the world to be perfect and holy. Satan introduced sin and brokenness. People followed Satan. Christ paid for sin by dying on the cross and suffering hell. And now people live in the midst of brokenness, but will be rescued when Christ returns. The message of the gospel, explained over and over again by Jesus. It sounds so simple,
But Satan counts on us thinking that it's so simple that we don't need to hear it. So simple that once you've heard it, you don't need to hear it again. That's why you'll find some pastors preaching complex sermons on the ancient customs of the Amalekites, or the function of the aorist tense in the Greek New Testament. Because pastors get bored. They get bored preaching the same old thing week after week after week. But that same old thing is the wheat of the field. The weeds are everything that obstructs our view of the wheat. The wheat is simple. Beautifully simple. Jesus Christ loves you so much that he was willing to die for you and be damned in your place. You sin much because you're weak. And that sin damns you to hell because you can't be holy as God demands that you be holy to gain entry into paradise. But Jesus redeemed you. That's it. He bought you back from Satan using his own life and soul. And that fact changes everything in your life. First, you can forgive yourself. You do and say stupid, sinful things that are not okay, but are 100% forgiven. 100% forgiven. God does not remember the last stupid thing or the last sinful thing you said or did. And since God does not remember it, you can forget it too. Second, you can forgive others. It says every sin has been paid off on the cross. No one owes you anything, and you owe no one anything. So holding grudges and keeping score is a waste of energy and a waste of time. I don't care if you are absolutely, positively, 100% right. I don't care. God doesn't care. And you are wasting your time if you care. Third, you can live a life of peace because you can see the wheat. And if you can see the wheat, you know what is important. All we have to care about in this world is the wheat. Everything I do, everything I say is wrapped up in the wheat. What can I do? What can I say to make the wheat more evident to others? What can I do? What can I say to make the wheat more predominant in my own life? And what can I ignore? What can I put aside? What can I let go of? Because it's just a weed. And it gets in the way of the weed. The disciples were not dense. They were just like us. The weeds were always grabbing their attention. The weeds were always trying to obscure the wheat. Satan, the world, their own sinful flesh was always trying to convince them that they had to keep careful track of the weeds. The weeds are what's important. The wheat will be fine on its own. Don't worry about the wheat. Come on, Judas. The wheat is fine. You better pay attention to the money bags. Come on, Judas. The wheat is fine. You better push Jesus to take a political stand if we're going to get ahead on this thing. You better judge that woman for pouring expensive perfume all over Jesus' feet when that money could have best been used for Well, for us, the disciples were just like us. They got distracted. Church is great. I can go to church anytime. Right now I have to do this, or I have to do that. I'll read the Bible when I finish this project that I'm working on. And I'll go to Bible study when they study something that's interesting to me. Or when they have it on some night when I'm not busy. The disciples were just like us. They were not dense. They were just distracted. What's distracting you? What in this world is causing you to take your eyes off Jesus? What in this world are you worrying about or thinking about instead of Jesus? Folks, Satan doesn't stop sowing weeds in the wheat field. He sows weeds every moment he can find because it's his only chance. He can't touch us. But if he can distract us enough to damage our faith, or better yet, even starve our faith to death, then he wins. If he can divide us from one another and separate us with anger and bitterness and hostility, then he wins. Ignore the weeds. The weeds divide us. Focus all of your attention, all of your energy on the wheat. The wheat unites us. The wheat makes us strong. The wheat tells us who we really are as the children of the living God.
give you thanks that you empower us and instruct us through your word and through your holy sacraments to keep our eyes focused on the wheat. Help us, Lord, to ignore all of Satan's weeds in this world, to always remember that you are what is important. Lord, in your mercy. We pray, Lord, for our homebound members that they too may stay focused. Lavera, Grace, Elizabeth, Eileen, Shirley, Bill, Charlotte, Sylvia, Otto, Georgiana, Doris, and all their caregivers. We pray, Lord, for all who are in need of healing of any kind, that you give them strength in their time of affliction and healing according to your will. We especially remember Marilyn Blakely, who is at home recovering from a car accident. And we remember the Schmidt family of Randy McAllister, who is suffering from COVID-19. We continue with our prayers for Bob, Peggy, Brenda, Nicole, Bob, Anders, Nicole, Jan, Dale, Gloria, Linda, Jamie, Eric, Lisa, Rick, Mark, Mary, Vicki, Kristen, Mary, Wilfrey, Helen, Deborah, and Alex. Lord, in your mercy. We pray, Lord, for the greater ministries of this church, especially for our seminarian Nicholas, for our missionaries, Jonathan and Cheryl, for our bishops, Matthew and Jameson, for the Asian Indian ministry in Chicago, and for more into the girl we sponsor in Indonesia. Lord, in your mercy. We pray, Lord, for our commander-in-chief and our president, Donald, that you would give him wisdom and strength and the ability to lead this nation in a way that pleases you. We pray for those who serve in the armed forces, that their time of service would be filled with courage and peace, especially Adam, Matt, Corey, Victor, Cameron, Josh, Neil, Paul, Quentin, Brian, and Lauren. Lord, in your mercy. We thank and praise you, Lord, for those who celebrate birthdays. Thank you for your life and grace for Kathy, Megan, AJ, Tim, Pastor Drews, Elliot, Derek, Ben, Marilyn, Marion, and Samantha. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend those for whom we pray, and we place them under your most holy name, in whose name we pray. Amen. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow upon us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death, that we might not die eternally. Because he has now risen from the dead and lives and reigns through all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death, and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, and receive
receive the blessings of forgiveness, life, and salvation that come to us in his body and blood. Hear us as we pray in his name, and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
O Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same way also, he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen.
Welcome to the Lord's Table. Thank you. now this body and blood of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you steadfast in the one true faith and the life everlasting. Depart in peace. Amen. Anybody have anything else that needs to be brought up? All right.